So when I was 15, 16-ish years old back in high school, I was like obsessed with Doctor Who. I had so many screwdrivers, knew a lot about the classic episodes, watched every single episode of the reboot up to that point. I loved it, and I still do. So imagine my surprise when 16-year-old me walks into Barnes and Noble, and right there in the front, celebrating the 50th anniversary, just a ton of Doctor Who books. Now, I picked up quite a few of these books, but I never actually read them. I think I read one or two, but that was it. For about a decade now, these books have been sitting on my shelf, unread, untouched, and it just didn't sit right with me. Unfortunately, I didn't really find a whole lot of information on these books. Are they good? Are they just kind of okay? What's the general consensus about this? Being curious if they were actually any good, I sat down with one and I started reading it for the first time ever. And I kind of just decided, since nobody's really done something like this before, I may as well give it a shot. Now, full disclaimer, I'm new to this kind of thing. You can tell how bad my lighting and audio is. I'm just using my phone. I'm looking over to my script all the time, and it takes a lot of takes to actually get anything right. So please bear with me when this turns out not so great. I am just learning how to do this. If you've managed to find your way here without knowing much of Doctor Who, we'll just go over a quick brief. The Doctor is an alien who travels through time and space in a blue police box called the TARDIS, Time and Relative Dimension in Space. He travels around, sees all kinds of different places, meets all kinds of different people, and tries to help out where he can. The Doctor is what's called a Time Lord, and the unique thing about Time Lords is that they regenerate when they die. So they just recycle their body and they change completely. Every cell in their body is different. This serves as a good way to keep the show going, even when an actor no longer wants to play the Doctor. Along with their body, their personality also changes. The Doctor always wants to help people, but how he goes about doing it and how he feels about doing it is always different. So if you hear me say things like the First Doctor, the Third Doctor, the Tenth Doctor, that's all that is. It's which number incarnation the actor played. All right, very brief summary out of the way. Let's actually talk about the books I've got. So I have six-ish, some collections. One of them is a novel with two books in it. But I can guarantee you a story with every Doctor from the first William Hartnell all the way to 11 Matt Smith. And if you're concerned and actually want to try some of these books, I'm going to do a spoiler-free review before doing a spoiler review, and I will warn you. I plan on dividing it up into chapters as well, so you can skip around however you want. In order of Doctors, we have the Third Doctor, played by Jon Pertwee, starring in Harvest of Time by Alastair Reynolds. This is a book written by a pretty prominent sci-fi author that I don't know if I really like him or not. It's kind of in the middle. This is the longest one at 365 pages, whereas most of these books kind of hover around the 300-ish page mark. One sentence synopsis: the Doctor has to stop a bunch of invading aliens that take over minds and bodies. Next up, we have Jacqueline Rayner's Earthworld, starring Paul McGann's Eighth Doctor. Think Jurassic Park, but with androids and Earth. Honestly, this is probably my favorite cover. It's got this kind of like vintage vibe to it. At 292 pages, this is kind of in the middle of the road. It shouldn't be too hard to finish, which is the nice thing about these Doctor Who books. Even if you don't like them, they're not that hard to complete. And for David Tennant's 10th Doctor, we have Krillitane Storm by Christopher Cooper. The Doctor arrives, people are afraid of a serial killer. It's Krillitane. Spoiler alert, I guess. This is the shortest one that I have at 239 pages, which makes me really concerned how you're supposed to explore a story properly with so little time. Next, we have Dead of Winter by James Goss, starring Matt Smith as the 11th Doctor. The crew crash in the 18th century next to a health clinic that is curing tuberculosis way too soon. 255 pages long, and this is actually one that I read as a teenager. I remember liking it and thinking it was kind of interesting, so let's see if it holds up. Now we have two collections. The first off is a 50th anniversary collection of short stories featuring every Doctor. 11 Doctors, 11 stories. With 501 pages in total, that is an average of 45 pages per story. Some will be more, some will be less. See, this is kind of where that pacing problem comes in. How are you supposed to fit a good Doctor Who story in 50 pages? I'm the most nervous about this one. I can't expect any of these to be like standout good. Not that a short story can't be great, it's just with Doctor Who, they're usually just so much bigger than this. Doctor Who has always fascinated me because of the different characters and worlds and environments that you see. So I don't know how well that's going to translate into a short story. Finally, I have this collection, which is a sort of Barnes & Noble classic cool-looking cover. I don't know what to call this. In this book, we have The Silent Stars Go By and Touched by an Angel by Dan Abnett and Jonathan Morris. It's got this neat little cover page. These are two full-length novels that you can buy separately, I believe, and they both star the 11th Doctor, Matt Smith, again, so I've got actually three novels with him, so that's going to be fun. 480 pages total, which is 240 per novel average. Now, this is a lot of books that I have, so I'm going to kind of go in a randomish order to keep things moving around. It's not going to be the same order that I presented this in. Basically, it's just whichever one I feel like reading next. And again, I want to try and put chapters in the video so you can kind of skip around to whichever review you're most interested in. That being said, let's get started. Alright, Krillitane Storm. Gotta say, not impressed. Alright, first I'd like to mention all these tabs. Don't worry about the colors too much, they're basically completely random. And while most of them, especially in this book, are bad, they're not all bad. Some, probably not a lot here, are for good things or questions that I have while I'm reading. Basically, if I have a thought while I'm reading the book, I put a tab in it. Now, as for the book is concerned, I was very much correct in suspecting pacing issues. I was about a quarter of the way through this book when I was just looking at the rest of the pages going, how the hell are they gonna fit the rest of the story here? Christopher Cooper is also really bad at writing characters, especially the 10th Doctor, who you'd think would be the easiest to write for being an already established character. Some of the dialogue fits with his character, but he's often just way too quippy, opting to make a bad joke in a tense situation instead of being serious about it. While the Doctor did have a tendency to try and lighten the mood, it was never to this extent. He feels like he's never taking anything seriously, and half the time he quips, I just want him to shut up. The plot overall feels like maybe there could be something there after some rewrites, but this really just feels more like a third draft, a few more revisions away from being a final and actually good episode. It shows promise, but it's just not there yet. At one point, there are so many plot lines running that they feel like they just exist to pad the book, and look at how thin that is. It doesn't have the time for that. Even if you really, really want to see more Krillitane, I still can't recommend this book. I've read worse, but I've also read less below average books. Alright, let's talk spoilers. This book has so many plots! I don't want to waste a lot of time here, so let's just hurry up and get through this fast. Worcester, 1139. There's a serial killer on the loose that they call the Huntsman, and the sheriff puts out a strict curfew. The Doctor practically forces his way into an inn to stay the night. An hour or two later, there's a scream as the Huntsman strikes again. The Doctor runs out and he sees a Krillitane over the scattered remains of a citizen. After the Krillitane flees, the Doctor finds a device nearby. The Doctor gets arrested, someone with access to technology thinks he's somebody else, and then she goes to save him. This is Emily, another character who is an alien that we'll figure out more about later. They're placed under house arrest, they escape, and then they talk about the Krillitane and figure out that the sheriff is probably either a Krillitane or controlled by the Krillitane after really just talking about it and having no evidence to back anything up at all. They break into the castle, which is really just a few buildings. They gain the trust of the guard Captain Dark with basically no effort at all. And the Doctor discovers that the sheriff isn't a Krillitane, he's just staring dormant at the cathedral. Are you tired yet? Because, like, this is being modest of the point where we are in the story, and there's still a lot left to go. Emily sees who she's looking for at the cathedral, a guy named Hank, and then she runs back to her spaceship to contact her employers. The Doctor goes to the cathedral and discovers the main conflict. A bunch of scientists are gathering Krillitane oil, an oil secreted by the Krillitane to aid in their rapid evolution. This oil has become an incredibly effective poison to the Krillitane if any of it gets on them. The scientists extract, study, and try and sell the oil as a make your species better elixir. Emily's employers arrive and it's a ship full of Krillitane. They didn't want Hank, they wanted the brood that Hank was keeping. Never mind how they even knew that Hank was keeping a brood captive in the first place, or why they needed to put the hit out on Hank instead of a hit out on the Krillitane brood, but nevertheless, this final plot point comes in about halfway through the book. Hank gives his presentation about his product to a bunch of potential buyers. Shit hits the fan, Krillitane are everywhere. A bigger, badder Krillitane that Hank calls the Krillitane Storm gets released. The Doctor sprays Krillitane oil everywhere and saves the day. There's a total of like five plots going on at any given point in this book. We've got Hank's plot to sell oil, the Huntsman plotline, Emily's plotline with her father. There are Krillitanes coming to Earth, we have to deal with that, and it is just so much going on all at once. This book feels like an unfocused mess, and the garbage pacing just doesn't do it any favors. I feel like some of this could maybe potentially work, but you need at least 400 pages, not less than 300. As an example from the start of this book, the Doctor arrives in town and things immediately seem off. He tries to get an innkeeper to let him stay the night, but they fight tooth and nail to keep him from coming in. No one's in town, no one's on the street, and it's a really good time to set the mood, but the author just doesn't give you enough time to make you feel unsettled. It basically just goes, there's an inn, no one's here, there's an innkeeper, the innkeeper is afraid, the innkeeper's wife doesn't want to let him in. Your setting should have a life of its own, and you need to take the time to set that up properly. It would be a lot more effective and make me a lot more uncomfortable if we took the time to look through the windows, see people shutting their curtains, describe the smell of the local bakery shutting down as it quickly closes its doors to meet curfew. Even the wind seems to stop as the last door is shut. The author just doesn't take the time to set this up and make me actually feel uncomfortable. It's just enough to make me go, oh, something's not right here. One of the best examples for the really crap pacing in this book comes just a few chapters in. The huntsman strikes, someone screams, the doctor runs out of the inn, just as I mentioned in the synopsis before. A person was just eviscerated by the Krillitane, there's blood everywhere, giblets scattered everywhere, the doctor gets on the scene first, and the police arrive soon after. They arrest the doctor immediately, despite him not having any blood on him whatsoever, which is stated by the doctor himself as to why he can't be the murderer here, but they just arrest him anyway and declare that the huntsman has officially been found. As they're taking the doctor to the gallows to hang him, literally on the same night that they supposedly caught him, and totally okay with hanging a completely innocent man with no evidence at all that he's the actual killer, the people of town come out to glare at him. Like, I get that they're scared, they found someone who might be the huntsman and they want to take him in, but they are literally taking him to the gallows to hang him minutes after they find him, and people ahead of the guys doing the arresting are coming out of the house knowing that the huntsman was found. I can't properly explain to you how ridiculous this is. This all happens in the span of like 10 pages. Don't worry, this rapid-fire pacing doesn't last for the entire story. The climax actually starts around the middle point and goes until the last 4 pages. Not only is this book really bad with pacing, it's also really bad with character. Let's go back to that random guy was eviscerated by a Krillitane bit, because it also has a really good example of why they think the doctor is just very poorly understood. Turns out that this horribly written exchange in the beginning of the book perfectly exemplifies everything that's wrong with the book. Every so often, you'll get a decent line that Tennant's doctor might say, like this exchange. This is right after the doctor had been arrested, and then Emily came in and saved him by pretending to be his wife. So, how was it for you? Asked the doctor loudly enough to get her attention. After a moment, the door cracked open and Emily stuck her head out. I'm sorry, how was what? She asked, frowning. The big day. I mean, it's the biggest day of your life, isn't it? Your wedding day? All those arrangements? He toyed with an apple he helped himself to from a bowl on the table. All those in-laws meeting for the first time, that embarrassing uncle dancing just a bit too closely to the bridesmaid. The doctor took a big bite of his apple and raised a questioning eyebrow. Shame I missed it. I can see Tennant saying something similar to that. It might be a bit clunky in its current form, but the spirit is there. But then we get scenes like this that don't really sound like the doctor at all. Keep in mind, he just walked up to the scene of someone who literally just died. There's blood and guts everywhere. So he just saw the Krillitane, it ran off from the corpse, and he spies something. Hello, looks like you dropped something. Don't suppose you'll have much use for it now. Think of all the times in Tennant's run where there was just an absolutely brutal death or a display of cruelty. Think about how sorry he was. Do you remember that line in Tennant's first real episode? He stumbles upon a sick person with every disease in the world, suffering, existing just to have sickness and suffer. He doesn't say anything. Rose asks him a question. What's wrong with them? And the doctor stays quiet for a moment.
I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
Think about how many times Ten has a moment like that, where it seems like it means the world to him to make it right. And for Cooper to just write him so that he makes a quip instead is just a drastic misunderstanding of what makes the doctor the doctor. No remorse, no empathy, just a quip. It's like all he knows Ten to do is quip and nothing else. This book is so bad at understanding why people love the 10th Doctor. It's not just the jokes, it's not just the quips, but it's also his ability to empathize. It's his ability to feel like he's the one responsible for everything bad that's happening right now, and it is up to him to make it right. And it's not just the Doctor who's poorly written, it's also the original characters from this book as well. Captain Dark, the guard captain, arrests him, puts him under house arrest afterwards, and then they escape, and then he finds them and basically just trusts them with minimal effort. Hank is also a dumbass. If he didn't do, like, one thing that he just did not need to do whatsoever, they would have been fine. I have so many notes. There's parts of the script that I'm deciding to cut out right now just because this book has so little substance and I feel like it's not worth my time to waste on talking about it. This book isn't horrible. I don't think I dislike it strong enough to say I hate it, but I very much do not like this book. At this point, I'm just glad I got it out of the way. Let's read literally anything else. I don't think it's going to get much worse than this. I sure hope it doesn't. Alright. Earthworld. Earthworld stars the 8th Doctor and his companions Fitz and Anji, who I believe are from the audio dramas, but I haven't actually listened to them, so I don't know. If you're unaware, the 8th Doctor only had one real episode to himself, a TV movie in 1996, in an attempt to revitalize the show after about 7 years off air. This didn't really work out, and the show was cancelled again until 2005 when Christopher Eccleston played the 9th Doctor. Paul McGann's only TV appearance and story that he has officially to himself was in this one single movie, but he has a bunch of audio dramas. I haven't listened to any of them myself, but apparently some of them are really good, and they actually let Paul McGann find his role, which is nice. Instead of getting into the story right away, there's actually an introduction here from the author saying she wishes she could actually go back in time and rewrite this book. Not exactly inspiring confidence. As I said in the introduction, this book is basically just Earth-themed Jurassic Park. There are a bunch of androids all over to make you feel like you're a part of the area that you're in, be it dinosaur or jungle or pyramid. Honestly, the premise feels very Doctor Who. I'm kind of surprised we haven't had an episode like this. I don't really know who the 8th Doctor is all that well since he only had the one appearance, but this book does make me like him. He has that bit of sass to it and the know-it-allness while still maintaining that lack of give-a-funkness when people try to act like they're better than he is. Anji I also sort of liked, though I wish she was more explored, but I am kind of willing to give it a pass considering this is a bit of a side story to an overarching plot point in the audio dramas, I assume. Fitz, however, he can get stuck on Earthworld and never be seen again. I hate him. I'll talk about it more in the spoiler review, but wow, I do not like Fitz. What is that guy's problem? I totally understand why the author wants to go back and rewrite this book. There are a lot of these tabs here that are just, this prose is weird, this continuation is a little bit strange. There are a few plot points that are just kind of there to fill time, and there's some clunky dialogue here and there. I've certainly read better books, but I'm surprised with how much I enjoyed it. It makes me interested in going back and looking for more Jacqueline Rayner novels to see how she's grown as a writer. Earthworld is actually her first. If you can get around the weird or sometimes annoying prose and a bit of messy plot, you can do a lot worse in this book. I recommend you listen to the audio dramas first, though. I would imagine there are subplots and character threads here that would just make way more sense with their given context. Not bad, far from good. With all that being said, let's just jump into spoilers. An opening sentence or paragraph is kind of essential to grabbing your reader and giving them a good hook. Ash fell from the sky, or Zeth, Sunsun Villano, Truthless of Shinovar, wore white on the day he was to kill a king. Those are strong openers because they leave you asking questions. Why is the ash falling from the sky? Who is this guy? Why has he got such a long name? They leave you with questions, they pull you into the world pretty efficiently and quickly. How does Earthworld start? A rocky plain, barren and dull. Nothing but gray as far as the eye could see. Another bad omen to go with the introduction. I'm sure there are worse openings, but that's pretty bad. In order to avoid going too far out of context, let's just quickly go over the plot. Earthworld is full of androids that are themed around human history. Some of these androids are based off of the daughters of the president of New Jupiter. The Doctor and Anji are separated from Fitz. Fitz gets kidnapped by the real daughters and starts to go on his own adventure away from them. And these three 13-year-old daughters are psychotic. They watch a lion eat a guy in a replica of the Roman theater. Fitz, who is apparently a musician, is forced to perform for one of the daughters and basically becomes her pet. Meanwhile, the Doctor and Angie are taken in as terrorists and are later freed by some actual terrorists. The plot just kind of goes all over the place from here. Fitz is an android subplot that goes nowhere. There's an Elvis impersonator who dies and it just doesn't really matter. Eventually we find the real plot, which is the president's right hand wants power, so he uses the president's psychotic little girls to try and kill the president, so they succeed, his power, and then he gets the power because he's their advisor. I don't know, it's kind of a wild ride. The terrorist plotline doesn't really go anywhere either. It's used on occasion, but it's mostly just there so that the Doctor and Angie can meet up with these other characters, who are also terrorists. There's also a historian who kidnaps and threatens Fitz for knowledge on Earth, because basically everything they have is wrong. She also threatens to murder Fitz for information that he was literally giving away for free just so he could feel important. And she has no reason to believe what he's saying is even true. He just comes in, contradicts everything, and she goes, "Oh, you must be a guru of Earth information." Like, bitch, you make no sense. And then she just dies after having, like, 10 pages to herself, which is being very generous. Not only is the plot a mess with subplots that kind of just go nowhere, there's also really annoying prose. This is page 16. This tab is where the prose started to annoy me. This book is 300 pages long. Angie and Fitz are the point of view characters for most of this book, with the Doctor occasionally jumping in with his perspective, and the two are just constantly interrupting themselves with different information. There are parentheses to add information everywhere in this book, sometimes multiple times on a single page. There's a part where they're looking at a sphinx, and Angie is just constantly interrupting herself to tell you how big it is. This is literally from the book. It had the body of a very large lion with wings of a huge eagle and the missing head of a giant-sized woman. Why? Why? There's also a ton of fluff. Right at the beginning, Angie goes on a short tirade about why you shouldn't stare directly at the sun. There are parts of this book to like for sure. Back to the Sphinx part, it always asks the same riddle. The creature opened its enormous mouth and began to speak. What? It's a man! Yelled Angie without slowing down. The answer's a man! Let us in! That's fucking hilarious! But this book has a long way to go before it can carve out all those good moments. Like I said, I haven't listened to the audio dramas, so I don't actually know Fitz or Angie all that well, but it feels like there was some connection that Rayner is trying to bridge from the audio dramas that she just feels wasn't handled very well. So, in the script, I wrote a very long sentence, and I want to keep it because I think it works, but it's also really long and I don't think I can do it in one take. So, Angie feels like she's going through an arc throughout the whole book and acts somewhat inconsistently, not sure if she's going to be a leader who does what she needs to do, even if she doesn't like it, so long as the Doctor isn't around, or if she's just going to hide at the back and let someone else handle it. Yeah, that'll do. This book feels like it's trying to give Angie a proper send-off. She just lost her boyfriend, Dave, yesterday, but the book mostly just reminds you that it happened rather than having it impact her. Angie is trying to help the terrorist teenagers, and she has a really important moment that would have worked really well if that's what her arc was all about, where she realizes that, yes, Dave is gone, but she's not, and she has to keep going. She needs to get these kids to safety, and worrying about Dave isn't going to do that. But she only ever worries about Dave on occasion, instead of having lost him be what drives her to do anything, be it action or inaction. In the vein of Angie being a possibly somewhat interesting character, there's actually a really good moment between her and the Doctor. And if you're wrong, asked Hanstrom, obviously unconvinced. Just keep your fingers crossed that I'm not, said the Doctor with eyebrows raised. Angie, who poured scorn in all forms of superstition, quietly crossed her fingers behind her back. Doctor, she said. Yes. When you've wired that thing up and saved the planet, could we please leave? He flashed her that incredible heartbreaking smile that she was so thankful she was immune to. Yes, of course we can. Behind her back, she crossed two more fingers. I really hope this moment is what drives Angie to leave the TARDIS. Angie needed a little bit more work, but of all the supporting cast, she is definitely my favorite. Fitz, though, oh my god, I hate Fitz. More than once, he has to remind himself that 13-year-old girls are off limits. Gross. During the Fitz is an android plotline, it's a notable interaction that he's not trying to look down Angie's shirt. Gross. There's a line that says his personal philosophy is if it's female, try to have sex with it. Gross. eventually, some of these tabs just became, God, I hate Fitz. If Fitz is a good character in the audio dramas, Rayner did him so dirty here. I wish Fitz tripped over a brick and died in chapter 2. God, I hate everything about Fitz. What a gross and disgusting person. There is a plotline here that is alluded to somewhat during, but mostly at the end of this book, and I do not care about it. Speaking of audio drama subplots, the Doctor has amnesia, which I assume is an audio drama subplot, and it's bad enough to the point where he doesn't even know how to use the sonic screwdriver. I assume this is just part of a plotline that I'm missing out on, and I'm going to give Rayner the benefit of the doubt and say that she's just patching up a weak ending to an amnesia plot that she just didn't like very much, because by around the halfway point of the book, it just stops mattering. It's still there by the end, but you can mostly just forget about it and it doesn't matter. There's not really much else that I want to talk about with this book outside of the conclusion. A lot of these tabs are just, the prose is weird, Anji is somewhat inconsistent, I hate Fitz. Oh good, another insanely long sentence. I'm just gonna read this one too. The ending isn't great. They actually spend quite a bit of the last chapter explaining that actually the president isn't the real father of the triplets. It's the president's right hand, which mostly comes out of nowhere and isn't particularly interesting in the grand scheme of the story. It feels more of a way for Rayner to include a plot twist than anything else. Far from a bad book, better than Krillitane Storm, but probably just skip this one. I'm gonna make it a little bit easier on myself and just read the First Doctor's short story in the 50th anniversary collection. I just hope it's good. It wasn't. With how short these stories are, it's really hard to come up with a spoiler-free review, so I'm just gonna say outright, this one's a pass. It's a bit rough around the edges, I could see it being fleshed out into a proper episode, but overall, it's not great. For spoilers, this story does a good job at giving us a glimpse at the First Doctor, and that's about all it does well. It highlights how he feels about his granddaughter, Susan, and shows off how gruff and grumpy he is all the time, and it just kind of builds a Doctor Who plot around it. The Doctor is in London in 1900, chasing some space pirates who chopped off his hand. Eowyn Colfer, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, but the author of this story has a really big problem with show, don't tell. I apologize if there's some lighting changes. My brother's cat is right behind the curtains by the camera, so sorry. There are many points of this story where he just writes what the character is thinking instead of actually acting on it to have that be the explanation. The children and guard have been taken. I must save them all and somehow end this tonight. If the author instead described the Doctor as being filled with anger and determination and demonstrated his drive, that would have driven home the point more effectively than just saying, "This ends tonight," to nobody but himself. The Doctor apparently also just gets flash forwards to future regenerations in this book. I remember reading parts of this book as a kid, and I'm pretty sure I stopped when I got to that part because I hated it so much. Oh, how I wish I had already regenerated to become the tall one with the dicky bow. This is so unbelievably stupid to me. Like, the Doctor just sometimes goes, "Oh, I think I'm gonna be someone who wears celery." To my knowledge, this doesn't show up in Doctor Who ever again anywhere, and it really shouldn't. This is a terrible idea. This short story really doesn't do a ton right. I like seeing Susan again. I like seeing the First Doctor, iconic as he is. But there's some seriously Hello Kitty. She has been running back and forth between the curtains and down here this entire time. Hello, Kitty. But there's also some seriously sloppy and rushed writing in here, and it's just not great. At one point, the Doctor's just floating through a tractor beam and just expositing to himself about the space pirates. It's written off as him distracting himself from the sleeping gas, but it's so obviously Colfer just trying to fit all the lore he possibly can for his cool new monsters, and it's really sloppy. What you doing, Kitty? Sorry, man, but that's just not how world building goes sometimes. You don't get to explore everything in one go. Like I said, short story, short review, this is a hard pass. It's really bad. The story is told through a letter or journaling style, and it's constantly switching between points of view for each chapter, usually from a side character, not typically Amy, Rory, or the Doctor. It takes advantage of characters who don't know them quite as well to deliver a story that's a little bit unsettling with these characters who aren't quite what they seem. In the latter half of the book, it follows Amy and Rory a lot more, but up until then, it's pretty much exclusively side characters. And this lettering and journaling tactic works fine at first, but then once stuff actually starts to happen, it feels really weird to be in the middle of some action, stop, go write a letter and mail it off, and then just get back to the action. It's also not done in a very believable way either. I mean, how many of you journal or write a letter and describe exactly what someone says, how they say it, their attitude, and what they're feeling at the time? It's just a bit weird, and you may as well do a point of view instead of doing an actual letter. The side characters are fun and likable, and I enjoy the plot, and I think it's a decent enough story, but I still can't really recommend it. I'm not going to go into detail yet, I'll get to it once we do the spoiler talk, but I like this book, I just can't recommend it. Basically, if you like Rory at all, he gets shit on constantly in this book. Don't read it. I feel so bad for the poor guy. The plot is fun. I don't think it's like anything to write home about, but it does kind of take advantage of the fact that it's a book. You have to picture stuff in your head, given detail on what they're saying. And once you get to that twist, it's interesting. But overall, I don't really recommend this one. It's fine, again, but I feel so bad for Rory. Sorry to keep it short for spoiler-free discussion. I just really don't have a whole lot to say about this book. So we're just gonna jump into spoilers now. The side characters are fun, and I like them well enough. Most of the characters are somewhat interesting because they're usually nobility or rich in some way, but they're not gonna be the highlight of the story. Sometimes they can feel a bit like components rather than characters. The Doctor's captured decently enough, as is Amy. Rory is not great, not because of him, but because of the world around him. Spoiler free, he gets shit on constantly in this book. So there are also moments where you're supposed to wonder, are the characters alright? Are you supposed to feel this way about a certain character? And yeah, it's all on purpose. But considering that James Goss doesn't really capture these characters well after the fact, it falls a little bit flat. Final thoughts. So far, this is the best book that I've read, although I still really can't recommend it. Mainly because poor Rory gets shit on constantly. Alright, so to kick off spoiler discussion, I want to address what I meant about the characters and feeling a bit weird by the halfway point. I kept it as vague as I could. It's basically using the points of view for all of these different characters as a way for the characters to not think it's weird, but for the reader to be like, the Doctor and Rory are acting a little bit weird, since you're supposed to know them and you know how they're supposed to act. The Doctor is actually Rory, and Rory is actually the Doctor, and there are very subtle hints throughout the first half of this book to make you wonder if Goss actually knows who these characters are. He knows them well enough to have them change places and make you ask questions, is that quite right, as you're reading the story. And he's also confident enough in his readers to let them ask questions instead of telling the reader, these are questions you should be asking. There are other points in the book that spell out what I think should be left unsaid, but as for this one instance, he trusts his readers. As for the overall plot, it's pretty simple. The Doctor and friends crash on a beach in the 18th century. They get brought to a nearby clinic, but they have amnesia. It turns out later that the Doctor actually did this amnesia thing on purpose in order to prevent a mind-reading parasite from sucking up the secrets of the universe that the Doctor knows. The clinic, run by Dr. and Mrs. Bloom, is using the mind parasite to cure tuberculosis about 100 years early, but it's only for the wealthy people in exchange for the information that they have access to. There's a brilliant mathematician, a Russian prince, honestly few others of little note, and also a little girl named Maria, who is, I believe, the daughter of a French noble. She's very young, about 11 or so, and also dying of tuberculosis, so it's a very easy way to get you invested in the whole cure tuberculosis business. She's a fun, endearing character, so basically the whole time you're reading it, you'll be thinking, oh, she's probably not going to get a happy ending, is she? Eventually, we figure out that the C, which is what we call the mind parasite, is being manipulated. At first, it was Dr. Bloom's wife, but then the Russian prince Boris decides to use it and try to become a major world leader. The way the monster is defeated is Dr. Bloom shoots the doctor in the head, and he dies, and Rory gives up the doctor to the sea in order to heal him. I guess regeneration is off the table in this particular instance for no real reason. Alright, so I guess to be fair, the 11th Doctor is actually the 13th because of the whole 10 regenerated twice and War Doctor situation. But at the time this was written, that wasn't a thing. The sea brings him back to life and steals all of his secrets, and because the Doctor has lived for so long and seen so much and knows so much, the sea basically loses its shit and explodes into a storm before it eventually just dies. Also, Maria's revealed to be a creation of the sea, so yeah, not really a good ending for her. She lives, sort of, it's kind of complicated, not really that important, and not worth mentioning for the review. Basically, she dies. In the end, it's alright, but I just can't get around to how much of a fucking asshole the Doctor is to Rory. There's a scene where the Doctor just fucking freaks out at Rory for dropping a banana peel on an alien planet. Like, I get it. This planet's not meant for a banana to be in the ecosystem. But, dude, chill the fuck out. Literally from my notes, I can't believe the Doctor hasn't murdered Rory in his sleep yet. The poor guy has done nothing wrong. It feels like the world is just out to get this man, and I don't understand why. He wasn't shit on this much in the show. When Rory brings the Doctor back to life in the climax, the Doctor ridicules him for it and says it was incredibly stupid of him. Rory, get some new friends. These people aren't worth hanging out with. Do you remember in the season 2 finale when Mickey touches the Ark on accident and releases a bunch of Daleks? The Doctor says he did them a favor because they would have blown up the sun in order to open it. Here, Rory saves the Doctor's life, and he basically tells him to fuck off. Fuck you, man. It's just so frustrating, because the Doctor is written pretty well in most regards, except for Rory. Eleven didn't despise Rory this much. This is worse than Nine's relationship with Mickey. That being said, this is, unfortunately, the best book I've read so far. There's the weird journal and letter writing problems that I've mentioned before. There are a few antagonists who just stand around and let the protagonist talk, work out stuff, and figure out a way to defeat them. But overall, this is a solid story. I still can't recommend it for fans of 11, though, purely because of the way they treat Rory. I just feel so bad for Rory. Like, get better friends, please. This one's good, actually. Well, I mean, it's kinda good. Jamie joins the Doctor for a quick adventure. The TARDIS is broken down and it needs to be repaired. You get a lot of lore for the creation of the TARDIS, and you get to see something new and interesting. This one's good enough. The story is a bit rushed, especially at the conclusion, but when you have less than 50 pages to do this in, it kinda would be. This would make for a good fleshed out, proper, full-length episode. For spoiler talk, the TARDIS is broken down. The Doctor and Jamie are stuck in London in 1968, though that barely matters. While Jamie is out looking for the chemicals to fix the TARDIS, he comes across a man being robbed. He saves this man, and he gives him a book as thanks. The old man, however, staged the robbery, and the book is the Necronomicon. I guess H.P. Lovecraft's mythology actually exists, or at least the Necronomicon does. They never really mention this again. Anyway, when the Doctor gets his hands on the Necronomicon, they get taken away to the edge of space and land on a planet. The TARDIS is taken to the Nameless City, where it's revealed that the Archons are the ones who created and cultivated the TARDIS's growth. The Time Lord stole the secret and destroyed their planet, and now they want revenge. The last remaining Archons fix the TARDIS by dipping it in the exact chemical solution needed to make the repairs. The Doctor and Jamie jump inside quickly, and they manage their escape. The story shows off a great relationship between the Doctor and Jamie. They get along really well here, and I really appreciate that. Instead of being a bystander, Jamie actually aids in the escape. He doesn't just stand around talking about how cool the Doctor is. He banters with the Doctor, and the Doctor banters back. I've only seen a few episodes featuring these two, but this book really nails it. Way to go, Michael Scott. As for the Third Doctor story, Marcus Sedgwick, you owe me an hour of my life back. This is by far the fucking worst story I have read for this, and I hope it stays that way. literally the entire thing is just spewing exposition at the reader. Most of this book is just paragraph after paragraph of unbroken dialogue. I decided to count up until chapter 10 to see just how many paragraphs there were. 253 paragraphs of dialogue, 114 without. Keep in mind, I'm counting Joe laughed as a paragraph. It's squished between two other lines of dialogue. Most of those 114 paragraphs are due to the two chapters that Joe and the Doctor are separated because they have no one to talk to, and they are doing some heavy fucking lifting. The first and second Doctor's story were so easy, I could just read them all in one go, put some tabs in, no notes really needed, and just go write the review. The third Doctor, I literally had to take a break and just shout, "Shut up!" In chapter 9, there were 4 paragraphs in the beginning and 4 paragraphs at the end. The remaining 65 paragraphs was unbroken exposition in the form of dialogue. In that dialogue, they explain the entire plot up to revealing, by the way, it's spoiler time, not that you should care, the Master is behind it. So what is the plot? Magic spear, the Vikings have it, the Master wants it. I actually remember reading some of this story when I was a kid, but I'm pretty sure I dropped it because it was so bad. And honestly, I'm gonna chalk the whole reason why I dropped all of these books on this one story. It is awful. This is fucking awful. This is horrible. Way worse than Krillitane Storm by far. It's a work of genius in comparison. How about the characters? What are they like? What characters? The author's too busy explaining the story to remember that they exist. They aren't characters, they're just human-shaped plot delivery points. God, fuck this one. Hopefully the next one will be okay at best. I'm cleansing my soul of this fucking garbage. Silent stars go by. This is the first book I've read where most of these tabs are high praise. Usually I've got a note to go along with any of these tabs. This one I just didn't think it was that fun to write, "Oh, I like this moment. Ooh, good character building. Oh, world development." Just over and over again. The Silent Stars Go By is not just good for these Doctor Who novels. This is straight up an excellent read. I recommend this one outright. If you've watched this far without knowing anything about Doctor Who, first off, congratulations. Second off, this is probably one that you can read without knowing anything about the series and still be satisfied. There are references to Doctor Who history, but for the most part, you will get a very good feel for the characters in this book. The world building and character building in this book are just excellent. I highly recommend this one. In fact, I actually recommend that you skip the spoiler section of this video and just go read it, because this book is absolutely fucking incredible. It's far from perfect. It's a little exposition heavy at times, and it just tells the reader a few things that I think would be better left unsaid or implied. But it's still an excellent read. That's it. This is your spoiler warning. I just wanted to make sure. The Silent Stars Go by Dan Abnett. Read this book. It's incredible. I'm gonna get into spoilers. You should not watch if you haven't read this book. It's really good. This book does such an incredible job at building out the world. The planet was found by humans, and generations later, they're still colonizing it, they're still trying to cultivate it and build a habitable planet and atmosphere for them to live unaided. Everything from the basic setup for how this planet is supposed to work has been lost or distorted. The evidence of this being very obvious in the world building. They live in a town called Beside, near a forest that they call Woodby. They have neighbors across the mountains in a town called Seaside. They have no weapons, they've never really needed them. This planet, from what I can tell, was completely uninhabited when they first got here. There are 3 towns across this whole planet called Hereafter. Their farming equipment is made out of what they call shipskin. Shipskin is just metal, except they started off by harvesting metal from the ship that they landed on. And it's not Beside, the town is actually called B-side, and C-side, and A-side. The forest isn't would be, it's would be. Their language and culture is so old, it's been bastardized and deformed. The book also speaks of the dangers of listening to a single source that was written hundreds of years ago, as if it had all the answers to life's current problems. Their god, called Guide Emmanuel, which is Guide Emmanuel. It's a not-so-subtle criticism of theology, and characters, once shit starts hitting the fan, begin to question it. Like, if Guide is so great, why are these bad things happening? Why does the Guide not have the answers for how to go about this? There's one character who, despite being shown evidence of ice warriors, doesn't believe they exist because the Guide never mentions them. Oh, right, ice warriors. Hold on. We should rewind and actually talk about the plot. Fair warning, a lot is going to be left out for the sake of time, but because you've read it and you wouldn't be here if you didn't, that's okay. The Doctor, Amy, and Rory, who is not treated like a pile of hot garbage the whole time by the whole world, land on a planet looking for Christmas. They miss. After doing some exploring, they get separated, and Amy and the Doctor are taken prisoner to Beside. Rory is attacked by people who are looking for a missing girl named Vesta Flourish, but then is saved and subsequently attacked by an ice warrior who is the one who attacked everyone. So clarification, this isn't actually an ice warrior. We learn later that ice warriors are on this planet, and we think that they're the main antagonist. But later, some other stuff goes down, and it turns out this isn't an ice warrior, there's something else on this planet, and that's the real antagonist. Back and Beside, Amy and the Doctor escape thanks to the help of Arabelle Flourish, who is just trying to find her missing sister. Meanwhile, Rory manages to escape, he hides in a mill and meets up with the missing Vesta Flourish. Together they return to Beside. The Doctor, while out searching for Vesta Flourish in the snowy landscape, discovers that the mountains in the distance are not actually mountains, they're the ships that the people arrived in, and hold all the equipment for all the terraforming that they're doing on this planet to make it livable. We then learn that the ice warriors are here, they're trying to take over these automatic processes and do the same to make the planet livable for them. Except the ice warriors need it to be a lot colder, so they tampered with the automatic processes and the machines, and now the humans are suffering for it. Throughout the book, there's actually a lot of conflict going on between the ice warriors and the humans. The humans don't actually know that the ice warriors are here, though. The ice warriors ended up accidentally and unknowingly tripping a defense system, and now that's part of the actual battle that the humans were never really a part of and they didn't even know was happening. The ice warriors end up actually joining the Doctor, they get the defense system back online, a whole lot of other shit goes on in the background, and they decide to leave hereafter and go colonize a neighboring star system instead. This book is a lot more complicated than it seems at first, with a lot of stuff going on underneath it. You will be constantly asking questions, and the book will slowly drip feed you answers, and it's beautiful. This book allows the story to be a part of the characters' lives and the world Dan Abnett cultivated, making the plot feel more like a result of what the characters do and how they live. He decided to tell a single, simple story and placed it in a world that has its own history that is discovered naturally as you turn the pages. Meanwhile, Krillitane Storm and the Third Doctor's story are so focused on telling this one plot that they have, everything else just falls by the wayside. This book manages to tell probably one of the most interesting stories, crafts one of the best worlds, and introduces or refines some of the best characters in Doctor Who. Rory shines in this book. They spend most of the time separate, Rory on his own, and the Doctor, unlike in Dead of Winter, trusts him to do what he has to do. This book is a love letter compared to Dead of Winter. He manages to get the Doctor, who is miles away, the guide manual, and he just goes, "Yeah, I knew you could do it, I knew you had it in you," and he praises him. There's so much love and respect here for one of my favorite companions. I really love to see it. All of the side characters are great as well, or at least they represent the world that they live in and make meaningful choices that are understandable. Honestly, by the end of it, I was practically begging for Arabelle and Vesta to join in the TARDIS and go traveling. They were so fun. I'm totally serious, this isn't just a great Doctor Who book, this is a fantastic book. If you're into sci-fi or visiting other worlds at all, please do yourself a favor and pick this one up. I don't know if it can get better from here, but I sure hope it can. I would love to read more fantastic stories like this. Alas, it is time to move on. I am going to read 4, 5, and 6 in succession before I move on to this next book. I have read way too much Matt Smith. Well, not a good follow-up. It's also becoming very obvious that these stories are so light on just anything to talk about, I'm probably not even going to do more than a sentence or two of spoiler-free review. I'll just assume nobody really cares. So, the Doctor and Leela, whom I know nothing about, I don't actually know this companion at all, land on a moon that is a tree. It's a big living moon, as if it's just a giant tree, and it's supposed to make the planet that they're orbiting habitable. Something's wrong with the moon, so they land, they go try and check it out, and it turns out the people of this moon hate the Doctor after 900 years of stories. They hate him so much that they literally name their children after wanting to kill him. Aggie, said the Doctor thoughtfully, I wonder what that's short for. The girl's nostrils flared proudly. My full name is Agony Without End Shall Be the Doctor's Punishment. This already is just really silly, and Doctor Who doesn't shy away from silly, but it feels a little bit much. The Doctor has no idea why they're so mad at him. Turns out the 11th Doctor will do something in his future, has done something in their past, and basically forced them off their planet. One of the people who lost to the Doctor hated him so much that he attached himself to the tree moon, modified it, made it try and kill the Doctor when he landed out of curiosity to check it out, and then was killed by the Doctor. Does that story sound like it fits in the span of 40 pages? Because it doesn't. People go from despising the Doctor to trusting him and wanting to help in the span of, like, 3 sentences. I didn't count, but I'm pretty sure that's generous. Characters are just dressing, no one really has any tangible motive for their actions, and the world is interesting at first, but it just goes nowhere. I need to be clear. This one isn't outright bad. It could have been great if it were given the full 300-page novelization like the rest of the books, but Philip Reeves just really wanted to write this one anyway. Look, I know 40 to 50 pages isn't that much to write a story like this, but if you only get that much time anyway, maybe you should just write a different story. This one's more of a disappointment than anything else. It had an interesting premise and it could have gone somewhere, but it didn't have the time. I am, however, hoping that there is some novel, or maybe the 11th Doctor story in this book is the event that caused them to hate the Doctor so much. It just would have been a really fun little thing between the writers to do. As for the 5th Doctor, well, 2 out of 5 stars is starting to seem like a trend. The story focuses on a couple kids in a small town in Maine during World War II. Everyone starts getting these truth tellers, which are like little buttons with frowny faces on them, and you stick them under your tongue. And once you have them in, they start speaking truths for you, except they're not truths that anyone wants to hear. It's always stuff like, your nose is too big, you smell like moldy cheese, your wife is sleeping with the butcher's son. Stuff that might be true, but people don't necessarily want to hear. At the end of the story, we discover that the rich people in this town are aliens, truth tellers are kind of their slaves, and they just feed off the negative energy that the truth tellers are creating. The Doctor blows up their house, takes them to get arrested, and then frees the truth tellers. This is another one of those stories that's fine, I guess, but it's just not given the time to flesh it out properly. This one is the shortest at about 35 pages, and so much of it is spent on explaining things that just don't matter. There are plenty of times in this story where it's stated that the main character is German during World War II, and that's why he's hated. And I think it would have been a lot more effective to show that everyone hates him and then reveal that he's German during World War II. Let the reader wonder why everyone just seems to hate this seemingly innocent child. They also explain that his father is serving in the war, and then they talk about it for a bit, which just amounts to wasted time because he literally doesn't matter in the book. So much wasted time here when there just isn't that much time to waste to begin with. And after all is said and done, the Doctor solves everything, and he invites these two kids that he's interacted with maybe twice to travel with him in the TARDIS? Like, I'm all for inviting new companions in these books, even if they end up having to say no, but Doctor, one, you barely know these kids, and two, they're like 14! What are you doing?! I'd love to tell you about how the Doctor and Nyssa, the companion for this book, are written, but they just kind of aren't in it. They have maybe 4 scenes in total throughout the whole thing, and they're really short. And you can absolutely create a fantastic story with the point of view character not being the Doctor or his companion. Blink in Season 3 proves that beyond a shadow of a doubt, but there just isn't enough time to flesh out anything else that's going on, any of the plots that are going on, and you're just kind of dumped the exposition at the end. So you're basically just asking what the hell is going on the entire time, and then in the last 3 or 4 pages, the Doctor finally comes in and explains it all to you. It reads as if you're just watching the side characters, and the Doctor and Nyssa are off in the background doing their own adventure without you. It prevents that rushed feeling that the rest of these stories have, but it also prevents an actually interesting mystery or adventure from going on. Instead, it just implies that there's one happening somewhere else. And the Sixth Doctor's story is no better. It's a Las Vegas-inspired city on a planet. The Doctor has a friend whose son is getting married. Turns out it's the Rani, another Time Lord who hates the Doctor and wants him dead. She's studying the aliens on this planet because they have this ability to transform, kind of like a Time Lord regenerating during their wedding ceremonies. It's not good. Pretty much nothing happens. Like, that's really all I have to say about this one. I was bored the whole time and just wanted to move on. I liked seeing Perry, I guess. That was neat. I really wish I could say more about this one, but I can't. How many times can I say I'm bored or it's alright, I guess? I've done it like 4 times already. I'm sorry this one's so short, but there's just nothing to talk about. If the Doctor didn't show up at all, there really wouldn't be much of a change in story. You know what would be different? One guy would have been kidnapped. I know that sounds bad, but like, that's it. That's literally the only difference. The Doctor didn't even do anything clever in this entire book. This story may as well have not happened. Whatever, I'm reading Touched by an Angel next. Well, this is a book that is apparently really good, according to one source that I don't remember anymore because this video took me months to finish. What did I think? It's good. I mean, Silent Stars Go By is definitely the better of this collection, but it's good. It's certainly not bad. So, as you can probably imagine by the title, Touched by an Angel, this is a Weeping Angel story. Love a good Weeping Angel story, but it's really hard to do something unique and interesting with them without treading old ground. And this story actually did manage to do that. I think it's a very interesting and unique story. I'm not going to go into specifics here, but it actually manages to create a Weeping Angels plot that we haven't seen before. Instead of having to stop the Weeping Angels, they instead have to stop one of the victims that they sent back in time from causing trouble. I feel like I should mention for non-Who fans who managed to find their way here, the Weeping Angels are statues, but they're only statues when you're looking at them. When you look at the statues, they have to turn into stone. They don't get a choice. And you can't kill a stone. They most often look like angel statues, and they're always weeping, covering their eyes because they can't risk looking at each other. They would be locked forever. An angel touches you, you get sent back a few hundred years, and they feed off of the energy of all the things you couldn't do, all the life left unlived. They are a very cool, very terrifying enemy in Doctor Who, and everybody thinks they're awesome. Now, there's a lot of fluff in this book. Most of this is just not needed and doesn't matter. It doesn't make it bad, necessarily. It's still a good book. But fair warning if you decide to read this yourself. The new characters introduced for this book are alright. They're not terrible. They're not great. Now, that should be a compliment, as the rest of this book is still really good. My problem is that they just don't fully feel like characters. It's hard to talk about this while trying to stay spoiler-free, but just know if you're looking for a character-driven plot, this probably isn't the one for you. That being said, I actually do 100% recommend this book if you're a Weeping Angel fan and craving more stories for them. If you're not a Doctor Who fan, though, I don't think there's enough going on in this story to keep you interested without the prior attachment to the cast. Now, if you'll allow me to get into spoiler territory, the Doctor, Amy, and Rory are trying to prevent one of the Angel's victims, Mark Whittaker, from causing any trouble. He was only sent back a few decades, so they have to stop him from creating any paradoxes. Much of this book is filler, as you're just watching Mark go through this checklist that he sent himself from his future to the past, which is now his present. Time travel's weird, just making sure he does or doesn't do the things in this checklist. While the checklist did get doctor approved to keep Mark living his life in the mid-90s, there was his main goal that he didn't actually talk about, which is saving his dead wife, who died in a car crash in 2003. The Angels, while a consistent threat, are kind of taking a backseat to the overarching plot until the very end, when it's revealed that the Angels are the ones who wrote that letter and want him to undo the car crash so they can feed on that time energy.
The problem with most of this book being filler is that the characters that you follow in that filler just aren't that interesting. You know what Mark's goal is going to be well before he even goes back in time, thanks to some slobby character introduction. The book actually starts with a car crash that kills his wife Rebecca. Then we flash forward 7 years, and his assistant goes, "Oh, still lamenting your dead wife? Anyway, here's a letter from 7 years ago that's written in your handwriting." So we know his motivation from the start, but he's not really that well-defined, nor does he have a great character weakness to overcome outside of saving his dead wife, which you kind of start to suspect is going to be the thing that he overcomes. So it's not even a surprise when it happens.
Pretty much all we see of him in this book is his past self wanting to date Rebecca, or his current self in the past. That's not weird. Old Mark longing for his dead wife and trying to find some space to be with her.
As for their relationship, we don't really get to see them growing to like each other. From the moment we first meet them in the 90s, they're already sort of lusting for each other, so we don't get to really see that relationship properly bloom. And the book bounces around so much, we don't really get to see their relationship grow that much either. So we're just kind of told that they work together as a couple, but we don't really get to see it that well.
Half of their conversations before they're dating are just about who they're currently dating, making me wonder why they aren't dating now since they're constantly bouncing between partners.
And we don't really get to know them separately either, so we don't really get to figure out how they complement each other's lifestyle. Hell, the most defining part about these characters is that they both cheat on their current partner with each other. We even see them at the end of the book meeting for the first time, and they're both willing to cheat on their partners.
I mean, hey, if you're both willing to cheat that badly, maybe you deserve each other.
I think that's really the thing that keeps me from rooting for these characters. I mean, we're told that they're supposed to love each other, and yet they cheat on two different partners at two different times. Like, are we supposed to go, wow, they hurt the people who are supposed to love them the most, they must really be good for each other? Despite most of the time the author talks about their current relationships, it seems to be negative, so it makes me wonder what the hell they're even doing with that partner to begin with. So we've got a book that's mostly filler and some lackluster character dynamics to fill that time with. Honestly, if this book spent that filler working on these character dynamics and creating characters that I actually cared about, I would be rooting for their happy ending. This book would be great. And to its credit, the filler is slightly used at the end. In the end, he decides not to save her life because if he did, he wouldn't have to go back. Mark interferes with his own life so much he practically becomes the reason that they're together in the first place. So if he stops his death, he stops having to come back, he stops having to fix it, and he stops pushing them together on accident. This final decision would have worked so much better and been more impactful if I actually cared about the characters and seeing them work well together. I would have loved for this book to make me want Mark to succeed because I know they're great together as a couple, but they absolutely can't. That dilemma between what's right and what has to be done makes for an incredible story. Truly, I liked this book, but it would have been so much better if we saw how they really, really worked as a couple. Also would have been good if they didn't cheat. That was probably not a good way to make me like your characters. My other heavier set complaint is how often the characters tell everyone else to just look at the angels. Like, the only people who are there to look at the angels already know how the angels work, so you didn't need to tell them that. Basically, every time the angels show up, someone's always like, "Look at them, don't blink." It's as if Morris knows that the line, "Don't blink," is iconic, but doesn't understand why. When Ten first mentions it, it's a powerful line. The angels approach Sally, who, by the way, does get a name drop in this book, and the doctor, powerless, issues his final warning. Don't look away, don't turn your back, and don't blink. Good luck. In my opinion, don't blink on its own is just not a very good warning. It doesn't really mean much without that buildup, and the more you use that line without any buildup, it undermines the original. It almost makes it feel like it has no business being so iconic, because it's just such a terrible warning. Maybe that's just me, I don't know. Point is, they remind everyone how the angels work constantly, and they always end it with "don't blink." Like, we get it. Blink is an iconic episode. The ending is handled well enough, I just wish that Morris was better at showing the relationship that's at stake. This book is good, and even as it is, it could very well make for a fun episode. Weeping angels are just always a joy to see. But that's enough of this story. Done with the collection, now it's time to move on to the next stories in the 50th anniversary collection. We're going to do 7, 8, 9 left. There's a joke in there somewhere, I know it.
So the seventh Doctor story starts with him and Ace stuck in a temporal nebula, which manipulates time and pulls ships in, forever stranding them.
After managing an escape by blowing up a nearby star, they get propelled through space and time and land near Skaro.
Except it's not the usual Skaro, it's a different universe that was rewritten after the star exploded and destroyed the nebula. And here the Daleks are actually a force for good and peace and science. They even operated on the Time Lord Lord President and saved his life once.
Out of the seven stories we've read so far, Mallory Blackman is actually one of the first authors who seems to have come up with a story that fits the length that she was given. Just a quick pop into an alternate universe and back. Now, this isn't technically an alternate universe. It's the same one that's been rewritten, so space starts to rip itself apart, and they have to go back. Despite having the greatest killing force in the universe reduced to philosophers and doctors, we can't stay here for long, and it has to be put right. Now, this is the second longest story so far, and it does what it can with its extra time. I don't want to be too hard on it, specifically because it just doesn't get a lot of time, but it does a lot of telling and not showing here. Ace goes from not knowing this one character to Blackman telling us that they're friends, and then at the end when they have to un-rewrite the universe, she mourns her friend's loss. It's just not done very well and it's really rushed. There are a lot of character introductions that feel pretty weak and rushed too. Give her something to blow up with Nitro 9 explosives and she was fine, but for delicate tinkering with a time machine, she was beyond useless. Sorry, maybe it's just me, but I don't see the relevance between C4 and the greatest ship in the universe. I really just don't. This, so far, is the best story I've read, but considering none of these ones are really worth anything, it's just not enough to base this whole book around. It's not worth it for just this one story. And once again, we get another Eighth Doctor story, and it's not good. It's fine, I guess. I don't know. I hesitate to even call it that. We start off with a good character display for the Eighth Doctor, and Alex Skaro seems to have actually chosen a story that fits the length of this, being about 40 pages. But that's really where the praise ends here. So there's a pathogen that lands on Earth, and it's assimilating all organic life, killing everything in this small town. The Doctor's actually seen the spore before. It landed on Gallifrey thousands of years before the Doctor was born, and now all Time Lords are immune to it. This pathogen is trying to spread and take over planets of non-intelligent life, so it asks a question to determine if that life is intelligent or not. Answer correctly, and the pathogen will destroy itself in order to prevent planetary genocide. I'm not really a fan of such a simple resolution, but at least it's a short enough story that it fits the 40 pages. And while the story works, the writing kind of just doesn't. There are so many, many times the author has to remind us that the Doctor is immune to this thing. It gets really repetitive and annoying. There's also another point where the Doctor doesn't have time to explain something to a character, but the narrator wants to make sure that we, the reader, know that. Like, the Doctor could have said X led to Y, which informed Z about A leading to B, but he didn't have time for all that, so instead he just said C.
In my opinion, that style of writing is just completely sloppy and kills the pacing, and most often that information is just never relevant again. The author just wants to include it for their world building. I think I mentioned in my Earthworld review, though that may have been cut for time or it was just notes, but stopping the narrative to explain something that's separate just kills the pacing. It makes it seem like what's happening actually isn't important. If you're gonna use the excuse that there isn't time to explain, you can't just use the narrative to explain anyway. It just makes it feel like there actually was time.
It's like if you're reading a scene about someone being chased by an axe murderer and you have to stop and comment about how everyone's garbage bins are outside, so it must be garbage day tomorrow. Suddenly, the axe murderer doesn't feel that important, does he?
This one started off alright, but then it just devolved into nothing pretty quickly. It's funny, I'm realizing that I actually did read quite a few of these stories, way more than I thought, but I just keep forgetting about them because they mean so little and are absolutely nothing. And this is one of the ones that I actually did read, and even back then, I remember hating how they handled answering the question just the same way as I hate it now. We start off with Evelyn, the one-off side companion for this story, dying. And then we cut back to the Doctor, who's getting ready to answer the question. Explain the ratio 1 to 812. The question shouldn't have actually been stated in this book. I feel like that's a huge mistake.
And then we cut back to Evelyn, who is still dying, but at least we're not getting to see the answer. I think putting the answer in would significantly diminish the impact of the resolution. This is supposed to be a question that humans aren't even ready to answer yet at the time the story takes place. So putting it in will kind of take away from that.
But we then cut back to the doctor giving that answer, and he's commenting about how easy it is. The doctor smiled. Every child on Gallifrey knew the answer to a question as elementary as that. A classroom question. Basic kindergarten 11-dimension superstring theory. Well now, he'd answered the spore. The answer is... dot dot dot. So we still don't get to hear an answer. What was even the point of cutting back to that? We already know the doctor thinks this question is child's play, so we just cut back again to not hear the answer a second time? The story's idea is good, but oh my god, the execution just does not pan out. It could have been great. It could have been the best one with this premise. It just goes to show that a great idea and a great execution are just two completely different things.
The Ninth Doctor's story starts off alright, then it hits a pretty big bump, delivers a lot of exposition dryly just in the TARDIS, and then it gets alright again. It's fine.
So this picks up right after the Doctor leaves Rose. He's lamenting the fact that he didn't get to convince her at the end of the first episode. He meets up with an alien on another planet. They go traveling to Babylon following a planet-eating and time-distorting monster. This story is also alright. It does some good, it does plenty wrong, but there is one part in particular that I want to highlight, and that's the alien companion. We spend a good amount of time not actually knowing what she looks like. We don't actually get a description, it's just a few minor details here and there. A spear bounces off her armor, she has like a claw, she's got some like whip-like limbs. Instead, the full proper description is saved for a character who has never seen her before. He describes her in detail and is terrified by her because she's an alien and he's a human and he's never seen anything like that before. It's a great way to tell the reader that she's not human, she's barely even human-like, but to the doctor he doesn't even think twice about it. It's not until someone who's never seen an alien before sees her that we actually get a description. And I think that's actually really good. I think that's really smart and is the best part of this story. Now there aren't really a lot of bad parts of the story, it's just the rest is mediocre. This is still one of the better stories, but the rest of the stories... well, I mean, if you've been paying attention, you know they're not great, and that's not really a high bar. I can confidently say, though, having read most of the stories, that it's just not worth the £12.99 or $19.99 Canadian dollars that I apparently spent on this. I'm American. I bought this in America. Why does it not have American dollars on this? So, Harvest of Time. First novel in a long while that doesn't star the freaking 11th Doctor. I swear, it wasn't on purpose for like half of the novels to star him. This book is the longest by far. It's got 365 pages in it, and my god do I feel every single one. Krillitane Storm was so bad that I had to keep reading it. The Silent Stars Go By was just fantastic, I couldn't put it down, but this one is just boring. The story starts off alright, but hits a real rough patch in the middle, and it just doesn't get any better. There were a lot of notes in here that I took that are just, this thing is dumb. Like, a character doesn't believe something is gonna happen, and then it happens, and several scenes go by, and then he's like, oh, so you actually believe me now? Like, yeah, probably. Is this a genuine question? It seems like it should be sarcastic, but it sounds genuine. The middle is such a serious lull. It is so exposition-y. I was gonna keep going, but I had to take a break. There was one session where it was just like three short chapters, but it just kept going on and on and on. I got so sick of reading it so quickly once that middle bit hit. It really just goes downhill. This went from a 4-star book to a 2-star real fast, and then it just got lower. I just got so bored of reading so much exposition. You ever like read something and then you get to the end of the page and you realize you weren't paying attention, so you have to read the page all over again? I didn't. I just kept going. I got so bored. I think this story has potential to be great. It's better than Krillitane Storm in that regard, but Krillitane Storm was so much more fun to read because I could pick on it for being bad. This story is just boring.
I looked up some information on this book, and despite starring the third Doctor, it was actually published in 2013. Apparently it was a favorite among fans at the time? I didn't find much. Info on these books is actually surprisingly difficult to come by, but like, did we even read the same book? People apparently really liked this, despite it getting the lowest score out of all of the novels that I've read here. Anyways, spoilers if you actually want to read this one. Don't. It's not worth your time. Plot synopsis. There is an invasion of Sild, tiny metal crab creatures that take over people's minds, and they just invade in droves. Water and oil rigs just start vanishing from the ocean. It also just starts to rain a bunch. The Doctor and Joe investigate. Turns out the Master is behind it, sort of. He's actually sending a signal through time in order to try and escape the prison that he's in at UNIT. But the Sild actually got that message, and now they're using that signal to invade Earth. Like I said, the water's vanishing from the oceans, but I don't think that's ever actually explained. I assume they're putting the water back, because the reason that it's raining a lot is because they're moving the oceans from their planet onto Earth. But they don't really address it. Anyway, the Doctor and Master kind of work together a little bit. They go to the Sild, they stop the invasion at its source, and they win. The Sild have already taken over a planet called Praxilion, and the Red Queen is hoping to have them reverse that by bringing them the Master. It's not a very complicated plot. I don't understand how he couldn't have done this in half the time and had a better story. My biggest problem with this book is its timeline. This book takes place during the Third Doctor's banishment to Earth. The Time Lords have locked it down. The TARDIS should not be able to move. So instead of working with that constraint, he has it move anyway. If he had his calculations right, he should be able to use the residual energy from the time distortions to override the Time Lord's control of the TARDIS. If he had it right. Just this once, he muttered as if he was talking to Bessie. Just this one time. Work. It continues to work like 10 more times. It pretty much never matters that the TARDIS is supposed to be locked down. Whenever he needs it to move, it moves by flying the way that it should not work. I hate this more than I can explain. If you want the Doctor to have the TARDIS, that's fine. Just move the story to take place later so he can have it. This is horrible. And once the Doctor and the Master first arrive on this other planet, they spend so long talking about it and nothing happens. They're not even doing anything. They're just talking and explaining what's happening. And then the Red Queen shows up, and they talk about Praxilion some more and do some more explaining, and nothing still happens. There are also quite a few passages in between action where it's just Joe going from UNIT to the oil rig, and literally nothing else is happening. It's just, hey, Joe still exists. It takes her, like, 8 hours at least to go from UNIT to the oil rig that they've already been to once and didn't seem like it was that far away, but now it is. There's actually this really long wait from when Joe leaves UNIT to when she gets her next passage, and it feels like she's just doing nothing the whole time, which she is. She's just traveling, but considering that it took no time at all and she's in the middle of doing nothing, it almost feels like she doesn't care. Which I know, again, she's just traveling, but nothing happens, and the time it takes is constantly being drawn attention to. I think it's actually kind of funny, because the Doctor is doing interesting stuff, and then it'll cut back to Joe, who's doing nothing. And then they switch. Joe is doing the interesting stuff, and the Doctor and the Master are sitting there talking, doing nothing. There's so much exposition and boringness happening in between sprinkles of action, where it feels like they're just trying to trick you into thinking you're reading an interesting story, but really you're only half reading an interesting story, and the other half is boring the hell out of you. I feel like this is a really short and underwhelming final review for the last novel, but it's so boring and there's nothing to talk about. How about the characters? I haven't really talked about them yet. They're fine, I guess. They're well understood enough. I mean, they don't do anything I think they shouldn't. One of the new characters, Eddie McCrimmon, is actually really awesome. I liked her a lot. I thought she was cool. Eddie, short for Edwina. She's the boss of the oil rig. She's the main one in charge that people listen to. Later in the story, she gets sucked through time and actually is the Red Queen who's been trying to save Praxilion, which I think is cool. Honestly, I really liked her. I thought she was a badass. There are a few notes in here where it's just like, wow, Edwina's really cool. There are a couple of one-off characters in this that I think are interesting or cool. but it feels so much like a deadline was approaching and Reynolds just had to rush something out. It's so far from anything good, and I'm really disappointed because I know Alistair Reynolds is a competent writer. I know he can do good shit, but this is just not one of them. This is for sure the most disappointed I've been out of any of these novels. This one honestly was so bad. And now I get the joy of going back to the subpar collection of stories. I'm so glad I'm almost done. Are you surprised that this one isn't great either? What is it with authors writing 10 as if all he does is talk and talk and talk and make quips and call himself brilliant all the time? It's not funny, it's not charming, it's so annoying! He is so much more than that. So many of these tabs are just me internally yelling at the Doctor to shut up already! Anyway, the Doctor and Martha are on a planet controlled by, like, a god, but the god has no imagination, so he just uses stories out of Martha's childhood to create a world. The Doctor defeats it by having it use his own head instead of Martha's. 900 years of stories, it kind of just gets overwhelmed. Basically, it just drowns. That's kind of the best way I can put it. I don't know, it's fine. Not great, not exciting, not really all that interesting. I don't know, am I getting burned out on this? Am I just sick and tired of reading these stories and not having any of them good? Most of this story just felt pointless. All they really did was run around and get chased for most of it. There was one pseudo-mystery, I guess, which was which of the fictional characters is the big bad evil guy hiding as? Unfortunately, it didn't really work out all that well. All of the fictional characters that he creates are supposed to, like, not even notice that the Doctor and Martha exist. So they find him because he's the one who did notice that they exist without, like, being prompted. Except there were a lot of people who did notice them. There was a whole band of smugglers who just noticed them as soon as they walked up. There was a kid who was spying on them. How can you spy on two people if you don't notice that they exist? Some of these tabs are me marking it down and saying, hey, you're not adhering to the rules of your own world that you created, except you were supposed to notice it with only one of them, and I noticed it with four. So despite this being, like, a big plot point for the mystery to be solved, the book failed to notice that it fucked it up! This book is just lame. There's not really much to talk about. I'm just glad I'm almost done. Alright, I'm gonna go read the 11th Doctor now. Oh my god. I've never read anything by Neil Gaiman before, but I feel like I've just been turned into a lifelong fan. Holy shit, this was incredible. Oh my god, this is the best one, hands down. Like, 5 stars, I'm not even joking. This was incredible. The characters, the plot, the resolution, there was so little time. I don't know how you fit it all in 38 pages. This is insane. I'm blown away. He fucking nailed it. This short story is called Nothing O'Clock by Neil Gaiman, and you should go and read it. It is so incredible. It'll take you less than an hour. It's only 38 pages. It's so fantastic. I don't know how he fit so much good shit in such a short story. Okay, so let's actually go through this. Spoilers. You should read this. Don't go watching this next part, because I'm going to spoil it for everyone. It's such a fantastic story. This is the only one that's worth actually reading. I mean it. You owe yourself this. I can't believe that such a short story had such a fantastic... It's so good. Okay, so the Kin are a race of monsters that the Time Lords put away. Now there aren't any Time Lords, so the prison kind of falls into disrepair, the generators turn off, and they escape. Well, it escaped. This monster actually travels through time and wears different masks to take on different forms. It's just the same monster, so you kill one, you kill out the whole thing. So the Time Lords put it in a prison to avoid genocide. Wanting revenge, the Kin decides to trap the Doctor and take over the universe. You know, like you do. Buying up all the real estate on Earth, literally no one can live anywhere. This acts as a lure for the Doctor to bring him in. It then tricks the Doctor by wearing an Amy mask, and he takes it back in time. Back to the beginning of time, to the beginning of the universe, so it can just spread infinitely across the universe. Except the Doctor isn't so easily duped. He brought it back before time, before the Big Bang, hence nothing o'clock. And he leaves it there to die. Genocide, because they killed a little girl. And I get it.
I was reading this, and the girl that they killed was so sweet and innocent. I read the part where she dies, and I just go, no!
So little time to establish this family, and I mourn their loss with them.
The Doctor in this book is probably the best written out of any of them.
What kind of thing?
Not sure, said the Doctor. He rubbed his chin. Gazpacho, maybe. What's gazpacho? Cold soup, but it's meant to be cold. So if we looked all over 1984 and couldn't find any gazpacho, that would be a clue.
Were you always like this?
Like what?
A madman with a time machine.
Oh no. It took ages until I got the time machine.
I can't believe Eleven hasn't said that. Neil Gaiman, from this one single 38-page story, might be one of my favorite authors now. The execution of this feels so intentional. Like, Neil Gaiman had an idea for a short story, and then he wrote it, rather than what all of these other ones feel like, where they had an idea for a longer story, but were forced to condense it down into 40, 50 pages.
I was fully expecting this to be crap. I wrote the conclusion to this video before I read this, expecting it to be crap. I have to scrap it now.
Look, I still stand by that this collection is just not worth the money. This collection isn't great. Not by a long shot, and it could have been a great way to celebrate the 50th anniversary. But seeing how great these stories could have been just makes me even more sad about it. If the authors genuinely wanted to write a short story and took the time to come up with a fitting story of this length, proper mini-adventures, it would have been much better.
A bunch of small, fantastic adventures, quick and easy to read for fans, before the special even premiered, would have been great. But instead, we got a bunch of rough stories, and at the end of that rough, we have a shining, beautifully polished diamond. A Neil diamond, you might say.
That was stupid. That was dumb. Anyway, I'm finally done. That's the last one.
So, thoughts about this whole thing.
Honestly, except for Harvest of Time and a couple of short stories, this wasn't as bad as I thought it would be.
Out of 5 stars, I just want to go through the rank that I had for every single book. Starting from the lowest, we have Harvest of Time at 1.5 stars.
This book is so boring. It had nothing going on most of the time, and there was just nothing to pick on or talk about. There wasn't much that was just outright horrible. It was just really lame. Also, it's got a dick on it.
Krillitane Storm has 2 stars. With all its random plot points coming together, it makes it seem like the world is lived in, but doesn't actually put any effort into it.
11 Doctors, 11 Stories gets a combined average of just under 2.5 stars. And I'll tell you what, Neil Gaiman is doing a hell of a lot for this last half star.
If you're curious, I'll put my ratings here for each individual story. Next, Earthworld gets 3 stars. Lots of potential here, and I'm interested in checking out Rayner's other novels. I think they're all Doctor Who books, so...
sequel?
Dead of Winter gets 3.5 stars. Not quite as good as I remember back before I had, you know, taste, but it was still enjoyable.
Touched by an Angel is also 3.5 stars, but I definitely rate it higher than Dead of Winter.
Not by a lot, but it's overall a more solid story and succeeds in the general execution better.
Finally, we get The Silent Stars Go By at 4.5, which I would rate it maybe like 4.75, but the app that I'm using to rate them doesn't go up by that much. But it's also not quite 5-star material. It has a few minor issues that I mentioned in the review, but overall, this is definitely the best book. This one is so good.
And with that, this video is done. Thank you all so much for watching. My vote is for Bill Nye as the next Doctor.
Thanks for sticking around. Really though, the video's over. This is just gonna be a conclusion-ish kind of thing to the conclusion. The intro and the outro kind of had a little bit of structure to it, but this is pretty much entirely unscripted with just a few note points that I want to hit. I started this whole thing because I wanted to see if Doctor Who books were any good or worth your time whatsoever, and the results are surprisingly mixed. I expected them to all be, like, really bad or, like, just kind of mediocre, but I was surprised with some of these. It didn't actually take me too long to read all these books from, like, November 18th to about Christmas, I think, was when I finished. So about a month and some change. I also read a couple of other books in between doing all those to make myself not go insane. If you're curious, by the way, these are all of the tabs for each individual story that I had. This is how many I had for Touched by an Angel. This is what I had for Earthworld. This is the 50th collection. This is 11 Doctors, 11 Stories. Unsurprisingly, it's a fat boy. Then we've got Silent Stars Go By. That's got quite a few. A lot of these were good. Most of these were good. Harvest of Time had a lot. Too many of them were just like, hurry up, move on, nothing is happening. This one is Krillitane Storm, which actually has the least out of all of them, because I wasn't sure I was going to do this when I first started putting these tabs in. So that's why a lot more of them have significantly more tabs than this one. But, you know, it was fun. Finally, Dead of Winter has that many tabs. For those of you sticking around, if you have any criticism on how any of this was presented, what you liked, what you didn't like, just how I can get better at doing something like this again, I'd very much like to hear it. I already know that I want to get a different editing software. I just used the stock Windows 10 one for this whole thing, which immediately I realized was a bad idea. That it's so light, you can't do anything that I want in it. I can finally rearrange this bookshelf in a much more significant way. I tried to avoid touching it over the last few months recording this, but there are some big changes that I want to make to it that I can finally do, because I didn't want it to be too distracting. Again, thank you all so much for watching. I really appreciate it. This took a lot more work and effort than I thought it would. I'm going to do something different next time so that I can hopefully get it out a little bit sooner. I already know what I want to do next, and I've got a few other ideas for things I can do in the future, so please stick around, subscribe, like if you liked, comment if you think it was cool.